Let's bow our hearts in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. And we've gathered here today because we trust you. We acknowledge you as our God, and we acknowledge our need of you. We worship you, and how good it is to come together and worship you. And Father, as we look at your word this morning, I pray that it would have impact in our lives, that it would shape our thinking, and through that conform us to the character and the behavior of Christ. Heavenly Father, I pray for your anointing, your enabling, that you would speak through me that which you want to be communicated this morning. I pray that you would bring your word to life in each one of our hearts and cause it to have your desired effect. We pray, Father, that through us you would impact this world around us for the rescuing of souls and for the glory of God. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So how do you make disciples of Christ? We're all familiar with the Great Commission. Go and make disciples of every nation, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. That's the commission, but how do we do that? That is the focus of this morning's study. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. And in this passage that we're looking at, Paul, Silas, and Timothy describe how they set an example for the Thessalonians and for all of us in how to make disciples of Jesus Christ. This text sets a pattern. It's an example that is being set for effective disciple-making. It is a pattern for missionaries who are going into the unreached parts of the world, like Paul and his team had done. It is a pattern for church shepherds, pastors, in discipling their congregation. And it is a pattern for family shepherds, fathers, a group of men are meeting, looking at the topic of family shepherds. This is for us as fathers in discipling our children. But really, this is a pattern for the whole church in reaching out to others with the gospel. And it is an example that was effective. As we have already seen in our study of the Thessalonians, the believers of Thessalonica were taught in this way that we're going to be looking at this morning. This is how they were taught. This is how they were discipled. They were discipled in the pattern that we're going to look at by the apostles. And the result was that in a very short time, they went out and were making disciples far and wide of many people all over the area of Greece. The apostles are now going to focus in this letter that they're writing to the Thessalonian church, reminding them of the way that the apostles lived among the Thessalonians, drawing our attention to the fact that their manner or their method of discipleship is the way that we are all to live who have been called to the kingdom of God. And so this purpose is iterated for us in verse 12, where it says that you would walk worthy of God who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. This walk that they're exhorting them to is what they're now going to describe. And so beginning in verse 1, for you yourselves know, brethren, that our coming to you was not in vain, or it was not a waste of time. It was effective. It was fruitful. And we are going to see that their outreach to the Thessalonians was very costly, costly in terms of personal sacrifice, in terms of investment of time, but it was not a waste of time. It paid off hugely. It was not in vain. It was very fruitful and very effective, and it is the pattern that God has given us in his word for our making of disciples. We have a church in North America today and in much of the Western world that is heavy on the teaching. And even that is diminishing in many churches. And so we tend to have a lot of knowledge of truth, but we have been very weak in the North American church, the Western church, very weak in the modeling and the acting out and the making of disciples by come and follow me and watch what I do and mimic that. That's been very weak in our churches. And as a result, we're strong in theology, but weak in the practice of the Christian life. Many of us don't know, well, what does it look like? Even the basic commission, go and make disciples, what does that look like? And I have to confess that for many years, my concept of making disciples was a classroom. You get people together in a classroom and somebody teaches them. That's making disciples. That's one segment of a much bigger pie. So we look at the second verse. Even after we had suffered before and were spitefully treated at Philippi, as you know, we were bold in our God to speak to you the gospel of God in much conflict. As you know, he's speaking to people. You know our story. You know our testimony. You know our background. These people knew them. And in the city of Philippi, where Paul, Silas, and Timothy had been just prior to coming to the Thessalonians for the first time, in Philippi, they had been publicly stripped naked, beaten severely with rods, and locked up in prison because of their gospel ministry. And then they were released after the earthquake that God brought to shake up the prison, and still badly wounded, they arrived a few days later in Thessalonica and began boldly preaching the gospel there, even though there was much opposition to the gospel even there in Thessalonica. But it was not in vain, their ministry. It was fruitful. And any time that we engage in the task of carrying out the Great Commission to make disciples, you are going to attract opposition. An opposition from the enemy that is intended to shut you down, intended to scatter and divide the church, to scatter the believers. That opposition can range from physical violence, which Paul and his team experienced, to something as seemingly innocent as all of a sudden my schedule got very busy, or the one that I'm trying to disciple, their schedule gets very busy, that simply crowds out any time to be able to meet with others. That is opposition to the making of disciples. And we must not be deterred by opposition or difficulty in whatever form it takes. We are called to do our part in making disciples, trusting that God will make the way as we step out in faith and obedience. Our call to participate in the Great Commission is one of our highest priorities in life. And when I say to participate in the Great Commission, we all have a different part to play. Not all are evangelists, the Bible says, though we all are to share. Not all are pastors. Not all are teachers. Not all are prophets. But we all have a part to play. We all have some role in the making known of the gospel and spreading of the gospel to all the world. And as parents, and especially as dads, the only priority that is higher than discipling our families is our own personal relationship with Christ, to love him with all our heart, soul, and strength. If you aren't nurturing your own spiritual life, parents, how are you going to pass that on, pass on life to your kids? And so first, love the Lord with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. Second, love your neighbor as yourself, and that includes the making of disciples. We must not use the difficulty of opposition or busyness as an excuse. Your high priority, one of the highest priorities in your life, higher than the making of an income, is your priority to make disciples. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. He'll take care of the income. He'll take care of the rest. You prioritize the business of the kingdom. Verse 3, for our exhortation did not come from error or uncleanness, nor was it in deceit. These are just simply three things that are very important to get right in making disciples. Your message, your motivation, and your method. Their message was not in error, it was truth. Their motives were not corrupt or impure, but they had right motives. And their methods of ministry were not deceitful. They were honorable. Verse 4, but as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, even so we speak, not as pleasing men, but God who tests our heart. To be approved by God means to have been put to the test and to have been found genuine. There are many false teachers, many phony ministries. And be sure that the ministry that you are coming under and exposing yourself to and exposing your family to is approved by God. Has it been tested and proven to be genuine? In the church, the appointing of elders is to be following the testing and the approval. The appointing of any leadership, they are to be proved first. So that you have that confidence that they are genuine. The material in our study today, these verses, these 12 verses, are set as a model for an approved ministry. If one lines up with these characteristics, and the main ones are coming, he's dealing with the negative in these first few, but in a moment he's going to get into the positive. And if one lines up with these characteristics, that will be a ministry that you can most likely trust in. Allowing us to face opposition and hardship is one way that God tests the motives of the heart. What is your motive in this? The testing will be opposition, hardships, trials, persecution, struggle, difficulty, and those are the things that reveal what's inside the heart. If you are striving to please men, or if your motive is selfish, you will not endure opposition and hardship for very long before you will begin compromising and doing whatever it takes to get rid of the pressure, to get rid of the opposition, to, I want people to like me again. And for parents, the pressure and the opposition can come from your kids as you are ministering to them, and you can say, well, forget all this. I want my kids to like me, and you cave in. If you're striving to please men, you won't endure. But faithfulness under pressure is good evidence of a right motive. I am holding true to the truth. I'm not giving in to error or compromise. My motive is the glory of God, not the approval of my kids or my neighbors or any other man. And what was the third one there? Motive. Or message, motive. Method. Thank you. Method. And my method is honorable. My method is to not be manipulative, to not be deceitful, to not just give them what they want to hear, but my method is to stand firm unto the truth. Verse 5, for neither at any time did we use flattering words, as you know, nor a cloak for covetousness. God is witness. So here he's giving, contrasting their ministry with the prevalence of false ministries. They lived, Thessalonica was a city that was filled with false religions. And it was a city where there was all kinds of philosophies and new religions and new ideas that came in. And they were always hearing these new teachings and new ideas. But there was a common thread among them all. And Paul is contrasting their method and their motive and the ministry that they had. He's contrasting that with the others around. And flattery was a common method that was used by the false teachers. Insincerity, in order to try and get something out of the other person. You butter them up and you flatter them. You say all kinds of nice things about them to get them to embrace your message and to embrace your ministry. Paul says, that's not our way. They'll whip us, they'll beat us, they'll throw us in prison. And we won't change our tune. We won't change our message. Nor was their message and ministry a religious cover for trying to get rich. Unlike the many other traveling ministries, their ministry was not a money-making scam. They had nothing to sell. They had no idols to pawn off. They didn't even take any money from the people. And verse 6, nor did we seek glory from men, either from you or from others, when we might have made demands as an apostle of Christ. They were on tour, but unlike the celebrities or rock stars of today on tour, they were not seeking to boost their popularity. They were not seeking to increase record sales. They were not seeking to increase the size of their following. They were not promoting themselves. And even parents in the discipling of our kids, guard your motive. Seeking glory from men can be a subtle, impure motivation for training your kids to live and act in a way that's going to make you look good. You want them to make you look like a success as a parent. Wrong motive. Wrong heart. If you are manipulating and merely satisfied with good external behavior, your discipleship will be in vain. That's not discipleship. And verse 7. Here, now we're getting into the positive. But how were we when we came among you? We were gentle among you. And he starts out with this comparison, just as a nursing mother cherishes her own children. Why her own children? You ever noticed as parents, you can put up with a whole lot more from your own kids than someone else's kids. Someone else's kid's diaper smells a whole lot worse than your own. It's just, I don't know why, but that's the way it is. Your love for your own kids. And so Paul and Silas and Timothy said, we were among you as a nursing mother who cherishes her own children. These missionaries described the way they ministered to the Thessalonians as gentle, like the gentleness of a nursing mother with her infant. She nourishes her child with milk. The missionaries nourished the new believers with the milk of the Word of God. And they didn't only teach the Word, but they loved the Thessalonians with actions, like a mother cherishes her own children. A cherishing of your child is not just the hugs and the kisses, though it's definitely that, but it's the constant care, the cleaning up after the child, clothing, protecting, training, correcting, carrying her everywhere she goes. That is cherishing your child. And all of us, men and women who are called to make disciples, and all of us are called to make disciples, this is the method we are to use in our interaction with those that we are discipling. We are to care for them like a nursing mother cares for her own children, including us men, family shepherds. Watch the nursing moms and how they care for the little infants and what They carry them and hold them and handle them like they're fragile and precious, or they are. And we too are to have this kind of devotion to those that we are discipling. And fathers, the discipling of our kids, we are to learn from moms how to cherish the children that are under our responsibility and care. And verse 8, so affectionately longing for you, we were well pleased, or we were delighted, to impart to you not only the gospel of God, but also our own lives, because you had become dear to us. Here's the two parts. We want to impart to you not only the message, though that's number one, but also our lives, our example. So this verse 8 is expanding on the analogy of a nursing mother and how she relates to her children, and it is presenting it as an example of discipleship. This is the way we discipled you when we came to Thessalonica. Affectionately longing for you, well pleased to impart to you not only the gospel, but also our own lives, because you had become dear to us. The mother conforms her whole life to meet the needs of her children. Is that right, nursing moms? The mother must take the initiative to pattern her life around the child. The training begins to reverse some of that, but it doesn't start there. You start by fitting their schedule. And you try and bring them on board to your schedule, but it doesn't start with your schedule. She sacrifices sleep. She sacrifices her schedule. She sacrifices her peace and quiet, her independence. She sacrifices her freedom. Sacrifices evenings out with her friends, sacrifices personal pursuits and career and so on. Ultimately, she sacrifices her needs to meet the needs of her offspring. She sacrifices having her needs met so that she can meet the needs of another. And she is delighted to give of her life to her children because she loves them. It's a labor of love. And this is what we are called to have, this kind of approach and attitude towards those that we are discipling. I'll sacrifice my sleep. I'll sacrifice my schedule. I'll sacrifice my plans for tonight. I will sacrifice what I wanted to do. I'll sacrifice my peace and quiet and my independence. And I'll sacrifice all those things because you have a need that I am called by my master to fulfill. This is the sacrificial way that these three missionaries gave themselves to minister to the spiritual needs of the Thessalonians whom they were discipling. They sacrificed themselves in many, many ways that they might pour their lives into the spiritual development of their spiritual children. And they gladly made the sacrifice because they were filled with the love of God for them. And this motherly example is set forth for all of us to follow in serving the lives of those we are called to disciple. And dads, the priority of discipling our children cannot be excused because I'm doing this or I'm doing that, or this is more important, or that's keeping me busy. The discipling of our family is priority. Notice the terminology used in verse 8, affectionately longing for you, because you had become dear to us. These are terms of endearment, but particularly that last one, because you have become dear to us, is a term that describes a close and intimate relationship found between family members. First Thessalonians is a letter that is saturated with family language. God is repeatedly described in this letter as their father. Paul, Silas, and Timothy relate to them like a father and like a nursing mother to their own children. And at least 16 times in this letter, these missionaries refer to the people as brothers and sisters. This letter is saturated with family language. A vital key to effectively making disciples who in turn will be reproducing and making disciples of their own is learning to relate to each other genuinely as family members. This involves not just attaching labels and calling one another brother and sister, but in sacrificially making our participation in the discipleship of others top priority, your family. There's family needs here. And that becomes priority in my life. And recognizing that making disciples is more than feeding them the word. It's also pouring your lives into them like a mother into her child. And recognize that verse 7 is part of the description of the way that the apostles were when they came to the Thessalonians. Or Thessalonians, which in verse 1 was not in vain. It was not a waste of time. This method, this approach worked. It was effective. It was successful. And so in other words, the sacrifice of love, the sacrifice of effort and time and inconvenience and readjusting our lives was worth it. It paid off in cultivating godly, fruitful disciples of Christ who eagerly went on to make more disciples of Christ and to spread the gospel, and the church of God grew. And verse 9, for you remember, brethren, here's that family language again, our labor and toil. For laboring night and day, that we might not be a burden to any of you, we preach to you the gospel of God. So there was work involved. The making of disciples is not a casual thing. Compare this with 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. Verse 7 to 9, we get a little more insight into some of this labor, night and day, that they were involved in. Verse 7, 2 Thessalonians 3, verse 7, for you yourselves know how you ought to follow us. Okay, they're setting an example. Follow our example. For we were not disorderly among you, nor did we eat anyone's bread free of charge, but worked with labor and toil night and day that we might not be a burden to any of you, not because we do not have authority, but to make ourselves an example of how you should follow us. In other words, as apostles, they had the right to be supported by the church. But we set aside that right in order that we might make ourselves an example of how you should follow us. When these missionaries came to the Thessalonians, they had the right to be supported. They intentionally chose not to take any support so that they could model the way that all of them were to live as Christians. They left an example for the Thessalonian believers to follow, an example of making an income so that you can support yourself while giving yourself to the making of disciples. Now, we don't know what kind of work they all did, but in Acts chapter 18, verses 1 to 4, we are told that Paul's trade was that of a tent maker. What the others did, we're not sure. But long hours of stitching together large pieces of fabric, not by machine, but by hand. It was ideally suited for being able to talk with others while you worked. Have you ever had a grandmother or someone younger than a grandmother who was an avid knitter or crocheter, and they can talk and talk and talk while they're working away. This was the type of work that Paul had, a job where he's working with his hands in a repetitive motion, leaving his mind free to be able to engage in conversation. He could chat with people about the things of God. He could disciple them in conversation while he was doing his work. And that left an example for the believers to follow. With his education, there were probably many better paying occupations he could have found. It seems that tent making was a very low paying profession. But this job was well suited to making disciples. And so it became, it seemed, his work of choice, rather than something that would make more money but would occupy his mind so that he couldn't be engaged with the making of disciples and the teaching and conversing with people. He would make his tents likely in the marketplace, probably under a canopy of his own, and there would be passers-by, there would be customers that would be visiting. He would be throughout the day engaging people. There would be people who would come and pull up a chair and sit down and, "Can we talk?" And as he kept working, he would be sharing with them the things of God and the gospel. Sometimes our obstacle is the work that we have chosen because it was best paying, rather than looking for work that's going to best accommodate the ministry that God has given me to do. Sometimes we need to make those kinds of sacrifices for the sake of the higher priority, the making of disciples. Their example showed how even a difficult job with long hours does not excuse us from our greater mandate of making disciples. And this too was not in vain. It was worth it. This sacrifice paid off. Dads, we must follow this example. Don't let a busy work schedule be an excuse for failing to daily give yourselves to the spiritual training and discipling of your children. We all must learn to make sacrifices, to remove the barriers, get rid of the excuses that we too easily make for neglecting the making of disciples. Paul, Silas, and Timothy are setting for us the example. This is the way we were among you, Thessalonians. And this is written down, preserved by God in the scriptures, for all of us to learn from their example. Verse 10. He says, "You are witnesses, and God also, how devoutly and justly and blamelessly we behaved ourselves among you who believed." Again, we see the example that was set as a pattern for discipleship. We lived among you. We came and we lived among you. They stayed in Jason's house, one of the believers. They lived with him. And so their discipleship wasn't just getting together once or twice a week for a meeting. We behaved among you. And this pattern of living as a role model among them so that they could learn from watching the disciples' lives was effective. It was not in vain. It bore fruit. Now, I recognize as I'm studying this and looking at it and pondering, how do we apply this to our Western society where we are so isolated from one another? We drive in cars where we can't talk to the people as we're going to work. Rush hour in Thessalonica was chatting with those that you're walking down the road together with to your place of work. It was interacting with people all day long and everywhere. We have created a society in which we are so isolated from one another. This is difficult. This is difficult. But the difficulty of it is not an excuse to say, "God, we're off the hook. We can't do it the way they did." Change that attitude and say, "God, show us how we can change to become more like this. Show us ways that we can change our way of interacting and living so that we can be more closely following your pattern that you've given us. We don't know how long they lived among the Thessalonian believers before they were driven out of the city by court order. And it was possibly only a month that they were there, but probably as much as 2 or 3 months, likely no longer than that. It was not a long time. A month to 3 months to get the job done. In that brief time, the Thessalonians saw demonstrated before them in many ways what it looked like to live a devout, just, and blameless Christian life. And they followed that pattern themselves. As the apostles 3 months later were driven out of the city, the Thessalonians, having that example modeled before them day after day after day, stepped into that groove and followed that pattern, and in a short time, they had evangelized a vast area of Greece and beyond. Theology and truths of the gospel need to be taught. But how do we live out those truths? That is hard to teach verbally. It is far better caught than taught. Caught from following an example of a role model that is living it out before you. As parents, discipling our kids, living life before them and saying, watch how I do this. This is how I want you to grow to live. Or as Christians, discipling a friend or a neighbor, living your life among them and before them, that they might see how you interact with others, see how you interact with your spouse, see how you work with your kids, see how you react to pressures that come against you. There needs to be both the teaching of biblical truths and the modeling of the Christian life. The Thessalonian believers were shown not only how to worship and pray and share the gospel with others, which are things that we can do in this kind of a context, gathering once a week. But they also saw with their eyes how to work hard as a Christian, how to be good stewards of God's money, how to manage their time, how to handle temptations that came their way, how to respond to those who mistreat you, how to care for the needy, and hundreds of other practical life skills that most young Christians in our Western world today rarely ever see modeled before them unless they are growing up in a Christian home. But if you don't have Christian parents and you don't have a Christian family and you're working in the secular workplace and once a week you come into a room like this where we're telling you and verbalizing to you the nagging question and the stumbling block for maturing Christian life is, how do I make this work in my life? For many as parents, how do I parent my kids? I didn't have Christian parents, and so now I've got kids. I don't know how this works. I don't know how to do this. How much better when you have that opportunity to see other Christians living day-to-day lives as a model, as an example. And this way of living that is being set before us in Thessalonians is incredibly fruitful. But in contrast to that, our sporadic attempts to make disciples on the occasional times when we are both free to meet in a coffee shop where they don't see much at all of our lives are more often than not vain attempts, disappointingly, discouragingly vain attempts. It's not caught. And when they do respond, the spiritual growth is very slow, because they have so little opportunity to watch and learn from us. In our Western context, we read that the disciples came in and 3 months later, they're gone and the church is thriving. How? How? Because They lived among them day in and day out. And oh God, show us how we can move a little bit closer to that in our way of living. Living among the people as Paul and his friends did, after just a few months or less, and the church was well enough established that it could thrive and grow when the apostles had to leave. Verse 11, as you know how we exhorted, that word exhorted can also mean encouraged or urged you, and comforted, meaning kept you from discouragement, persuaded you to keep on going, and charged, meaning we set the course, we gave the commission, here is your responsibility, go in it. So we exhorted and comforted and charged every one of you as a father does his own children. Here again, we see family language coming in as a pattern for the way the Christians are to live as and disciple as a father does his own children. We need to learn how to apply this pattern to our relationships as a church. In that day, the fathers had the primary responsibility for the moral and spiritual training of the children, and the Bible endorses that as the pattern for the church. Dads, again, we have the primary responsibility for the moral and spiritual discipleship and training of our kids. Yes, the mothers play a massive role as well, but the dads are called by God to lead the way and to be forefront in this task. For example, Ephesians 6 instructs children to honor their father and their mother. But then verse 4 singles out the fathers with this instruction, bring up your children in the training and admonition of the Lord. In the making of disciples, the more mature Christian is to relate to the newer believer not only as a loving, nurturing mother caring for her child, but also as a father providing the spiritual training and the mentorship and the moral role modeling for that one you're discipling. And this is how these missionaries carried out their task of making disciples, and it was not in vain. It became a pattern for living that the Thessalonians followed. And verse 12, that you would walk worthy. We gave you this exhortation. We gave you this comfort, encouragement, persuasion, and we gave you this charge that you would walk worthy of God who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. All of the way that is of living that has been laid out in these verses we've looked at this morning, acting with integrity, proclaiming truth, not error, in everything being motivated out of pure love for God, living as family in our relationships to the brothers and sisters of Christ, and sacrificing self for the sake of making disciples, changing our lives and inconvenience ourselves so that we can make it happen. All of this is now summarized as walking worthy of the God who calls you. To walk worthy of God does not mean that you're living in such a way that by your good works you make yourself worthy of God's acceptance. That's not at all what it's talking about here. To walk worthy of God means to live a life that is worthy of being held up as an example to others of what it looks like when God is living in a person. Jesus Christ lives in me is our testimony, is our witness. And watch what it looks like when we let Jesus live in us. That is to walk a life worthy of being tagged Jesus in me, tagged child of God, tagged Christ follower. Paul taught in Galatians 2:20 that as a Christian, it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. and therefore to live out that reality, to let the Christ who is in you live his life through you, as you, only that is a life worthy of being attributed to God. Don't live your own life, your own way, self-indulgent, and call it Christ following. God in me. God gets no glory for what we do out of our own flesh. God is only glorified by what we let him do through us. The life of sacrificial discipleship described in these verses is the kind of life that God will lead us into and that he will work out through us if we yield our beings to his control and say, here I am, use me, send me. And such a life is worthy of God, who calls us to go and make disciples. Father, we confess that we have probably been discipled more by the movies, television, celebrities, peers at school, the world all around us. God, that has often, for many of us, been a greater shaping influence than the lives of other Christians, mature and godly lives. Lord, many of us have been frustrated and hindered in our ability to make disciples because we have never been discipled. Teach us, Lord. Show us. Change all of that for the next generation. I pray in Jesus' name that you would motivate and empower our parents to ever increasingly live lives worthy of God before their children, that their children might see Christ in them, and that their children might see by example in dad and mom how to deal with and face the problems, the trials, the struggles of life, how to worship and rejoice and give thanks in all things, how to handle money and handle temptation, how to repent when needed, and how to care for the poor and the needy and the downtrodden, how to set aside our priorities, our plans, our desires for your priorities. Lord, let that be exemplified and modeled by our parents to our children. And Lord, let that be exemplified and modeled by each and every one of us in our relationships to those around us whom we are asking you to disciple through us. We're praying for lost souls. We're praying for lost neighbors. We're praying for lost relatives. We're praying for lost colleagues and classmates. And, oh, Lord God, I pray that you would teach us how to nurture them like a mother cherishes her own children, and that you would teach us how to train and model for them as a father his children. Lord, teach us these patterns, these principles, that the next generation would not be able to say, I don't know how to disciple, but that they would be doing it because it has been set before them. And Lord, we ask you to show us how to change from our dysfunctional Western culture into a more biblical, family-oriented way of living amongst ourselves and in relationship to others. We need your guidance. We need your wisdom. We need your motivation to make those sacrificial changes that are going to look weird in the eyes of some, but oh, how they are going to make a difference in our ability to make disciples. We pray this, Lord. Help us. Help us. Enable us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.